Hello and welcome to Latest TV News. I'm Yael Breuer and here are your local and national headlines for tonight. As we now focus on the recovery in our city, we look at how local businesses are getting back to work and adapting to new realities.
So welcome back to the vote. I'm here with Lloyd Russell-Moyle, MP, MP for Brighton Kemptown, Labour MP, I should say. And we were talking about the coronavirus pandemic and how, what that means for the city. You were talking about businesses getting back up and running. That's going to be crucial, isn't it? We need more government funding, really, don't we?
You
were rightly saying.
We need some sectoral deals.
Yeah.
So in the airline industry, we need a sectoral deal that helps transform them into a greener industry and a greener transport industry more broadly. And at the moment, it just seems to be bailout after bailout. At least the German government's taking cuts from the company. You know, they take shares from the company when they bail them out. And then we see them sacking lots of workers, which is really no good. Particularly British Airways has been behaving appallingly, how they've really got rid of lots of their workers despite receiving government money. And then in the tourist industry here in the city, the hospitality industry, the events industry, those broader industries that we really rely on here in Brighton, there needs to be something specific for them, because if we don't, because of their seasonality and their cyclical nature in the year, then they will suffer 2-3 winters effectively. They've had a winter before, in the summer period and up to the summer period we've shut down, and then you'll have a winter at the end. And that would kill a lot of businesses. So we need some support. We need some way of getting people to the British seaside.
Yeah.
And so we need some ways of doing that. And we need government action on that, as well as a better way of supporting people back into work. I think the government made some big mistakes in terms of rent, requiring businesses to continue to pay rents when they weren't opening. They should have provided a support scheme for that, and they haven't. I know a pub just on this road, in fact.
Was anyone?
who has had an issue that they received a small grant from the council, and then their landlord said, oh, you've received the small grant, give it all to me in rent, every single penny. And so no money then to pay any of the suppliers, no money to pay for the bills, no money to help keep them going when they have to reopen. Because when you reopen, you're going to make a loss for a few months.
We'll have to leave. They will run out of time. We'll catch up again soon. Lloyd, thanks for talking to us. So I'm joined here today by Kate Solly Hub and Faye Bridgewater, both local artists. And you won awards, didn't you, Katie and Faye? Just tell us all about them.
So it's the De Went Art Prize, and De Went are a pencil manufacturer, and it's a drawing prize. So you send your work in, and I think there was something like 5,000 entries this year, and we were both shortlisted. We both live in the area and we don't know each other, so it's really wonderful. So my piece is all about the murmurations. I run a photographic group in Brighton called Brighton Skies on Facebook, and we've got nearly 14,000 members. And when the murmurations happen, we get thousands of photos and videos of these beautiful swirling shapes of the starlings between the two piers. And I wanted to capture it somehow. So I drew 140 squares, almost like when you're flicking through your phone, going through images quite quickly, and tried to capture the essence of a murmuration. So I kind of got my pencil and I stabbed the paper, trying to get the energy of a murmuration.
Yeah. And Katie, tell us a bit about your artwork and a bit more about this prize and why you decided to enter it.
Yeah, so my artwork is a drawing of an interior space, and that's a lot of my work. It's about houses and being inside rooms, that kind of feeling of, especially empty rooms of old historic houses. I love that atmosphere. So that's what my work is about. Mine was selected from the shortlisted from 5,000 down to 70, from 70 down to one first prize winner, which was me. So that was just unbelievable. I only heard about it on social media. I didn't even think of the first prize. I didn't even know there was prize money involved. So that was just incredible altogether. That wasn't why I entered. I entered just to be part of a drawing, a celebration of drawing.
Faye, maybe you first. You're going to be exploring lockdown. And what have you learnt from lockdown? Because I'm thinking artists, it's quite a solitary experience, isn't it? And you often want to be left alone anyway half the time to get on with the painting.
The one thing I am doing, actually, because I did study photography as well, I am doing a photographic diary every day. So I think I'm on day 55 now. Taking 5 photos. Well, I take hundreds of photos a day, but I select 5. I edit it down to 5 photos a day of their experience of the lockdown. So hopefully it's kind of a historic document for us all to be able to look at in the future.
If you take nice photographs of your cats and you want to put them to some good use, we have the right man to talk about this. This is
Kevin Smith. Hello, Kevin.
And hi, Anne.
You're a volunteer for the Cats Protection Brighton branch. And
that's right.
You come up with an idea for a nice exhibition and competition, really, to do with cats' photos. Do you want to tell me a little bit about it?
Sure, yeah. So we're quite active at the Cats Protection Brighton branch. And obviously at the moment with lockdown, some of the usual activities are on hold. But we have quite a energetic publicity branch of the group. And it was thought, well, why don't we have a competition so that anyone can submit their favourite photos of their cats, because we're all spending a lot more time with our cats at the moment, kind of enforced, but usually a good thing. You know, more time with cats is never a bad thing.
And there's no arguing that you know, photos of cute cats are the absolute winners of social media.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, the heavyweights of social media pics. Yeah, and everyone takes loads of photos of their cats all the time, and they might just be clogging up your phone or something, but on your phone there might be like a competition winner, you know, so why not submit it and see?
Absolutely.
How far
so people can submit the photos, there'll be some judging involved and there'll be some modest prizes for those photos selected, but obviously you know, this will raise the profile of the fantastic work that you do. I know that you're a photographer anyway, not just of cats, and if people want to have a look at your own photos, which is something I've done and thoroughly enjoyed it, then do you want to just mention the website for your own photography website?
Yeah, sure. It's kevinsmithphoto.org.
That's great. And if people do want to go ahead and submit photos for the cat photo competition, how do they do that?
They can email their photos, as many as they like, I think. But obviously, like, try to choose your best ones. Sure. And send them to this email address. So it's publicity@brighton.cats.uk.
And so what's the absolute deadline?
June the 8th, midnight.
June the 8th, midnight. Lovely. Thank you so much, Kevin, for joining us.
Thank you, Al. Thank you. Bye-bye.
While lockdown continues to separate us from our families, it is easy to see why many people are seeking the company of a furry companion. In recent weeks, searches for buying a puppy have increased by 120%, according to the Dogs Trust. This has led to concerns that these lockdown puppies will be abandoned as life slowly begins to return to normal and owners head back to work.
What's happening at the moment is actually the reality of what's going to happen when they go back to work. So they may have all the time to look after a dog at the moment, and what we are starting to see is people giving us a call saying, I need to go back to work in a few weeks, and I bought a dog during lockdown, and the dog's going to start having behaviour problems, and I haven't got time for it.
The Kennel Club has also warned against impulsive purchases. In an official statement, they said, "Whilst a puppy might seem like a good distraction, today's situation is far from ideal to raise a puppy. Puppies will help us through this uncertain time and we need to help them too." And a helping hand has certainly been offered here at Shoreham Dogs Trust. The centre has been overwhelmed with donations and generosity from the general public.
We've had loads of requests for fostering, we've had loads of requests for rehoming at the moment, and we pretty much use, we think, everyone we can at the moment, but it's overwhelming, the support that we've been offered, and if we can use you to help, then we will, if you've offered. So a thank you to everyone that's done that as well.
So if you are thinking about getting a dog, remember that a dog is for life and not just for lockdown. Olivia Marshall, latest TV news.
And that's it for the first half. Join us for the second half for a look at what's on in Brighton and a football review.
Remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV.
Welcome back to Latest TV News. I'm Yael Breuer. Now, for our coronavirus update.
So back to dentistry services at Yale, and we've covered this a lot in the news, haven't we? You can now access dental care, but it's not the whole story. I know you've heard from your dentist, and I heard from my dentist that really it's just emergency appointments that people can have access to.
Yeah, I literally had a text from my dentist 10 minutes ago, and it's not the first one. And it says, "Dear patients, although we appreciate that the government have announced that it's okay to open dental practices from the 8th of June, we will not be returning to normal dentistry." And then they add, "Your safety is our top priority." I just wonder if there is some kind of underlying message here saying, you know, whoa, we're not going to just say what the government says, you know, on a sort of arbitrary basis, but we are, you know, we are kind of assessing the situation on our own. You know, I suppose it is a little bit odd with all these dates that are being kind of given from, you know, someone thinks up dates and it's not safe to do something before, but it's okay to do it after a particular day.
And that is confusing, I think. I think you're right, because what I heard from my dentist as well is that, you know, they gave away like their PPE, their personal protective equipment, to the NHS. And then they're having to then get extra PPE equipment. They obviously use it anyway before the coronavirus outbreak, but they need enhanced PPE, and that's more expensive now, and also it's difficult to get hold of. So it's really interesting. I know we focused on a, you know, three dentists. I think it was Dental Health Spa, Concordia Dental Care as well, and we've also heard from patients during the latest TV news about their dentistry experiences. Mm-hmm. So things are back up and running, but I think having that availability and what you can, treatments are available to all patients is a bit confusing at the moment.
I think the thing that's not confusing is the fact that dentistry uses the aerosol, you know, the drilling.
Yes.
And that is not deemed safe.
Yes. Which was the main reason why they had to close down immediately.
Exactly.
And it was literally overnight because of that dental treatment. It creates this aerosol, which obviously can contain droplets of the coronavirus.
But at the same time, there isn't any dentistry without the drilling, you know, kind of treatment. I mean, there is, but, you know, you need to have some work done by a dentist. It's very often involves drilling, and you know, a date has been given, the 8th of June. Then there'll be something in July. Then there'll be September. But until the coronavirus is no longer here, if such a day comes, when is it going to be okay to have a dental treatment that involves drilling? That's nobody knows.
It's a difficult one, yeah. Mm. And I know that Health Watch have been giving us updates about all types of healthcare, including dentistry healthcare. So if people go to the Health Watch website, Health Watch Brighton Hove, then they'll get lots of different advice. And I did speak to Jeffrey Bowden, who's a director of Health Watch. We're going to hear from him shortly. But it's also important that people just pick up their routine appointments, you know, for scans, you know, if they have an ailment or something they think they need to check out by a GP, get in contact with your healthcare professional, your GP, because there is capacity now. And I think that's a message that the government, I know Jeffrey Bowden says that as well, healthcare professionals as well, they're saying, get in contact with your...
Get back to the routine of kind of following up.
It particularly, yeah, I think that's really important. So, OK, we're now going to hear from Jeffrey Bowden from Health Watch, Director of Health Watch. This is what he had to say. So we're now going to hear from Mike Mendoza from Latest TV News. This is what he had to say.
So I'm here with Mike Mendoza for this episode of The Vote. And Mike, we're going to be talking about the coronavirus pandemic. We're quite a way into the pandemic now. We've hit the peak and we're all looking at the numbers in a way, aren't we? Both the death toll, but also the economic numbers. That's where we seem to be at the moment. Maybe the death toll. Should we start off with that? We've got to remember those lives that have been lost. It's been a high death toll, hasn't it, really? A lot more than what most people thought, do you think?
And even more than they initially thought. If you remember, I think they said at 20,000, we'd be lucky. It's a horrible thing to say. You're going to be lucky having 20,000 people die. As you know, we've gone well over that now. People just haven't sorted it out properly, have they? And all the arguments over lockdown, when it should have been, did we do it a week late? I don't think a week would have made an awful lot of difference.
Yeah. Yeah, that was Neil Ferguson you were referring to there. So,
yeah.
And that was interesting. He mentioned that. Do you think that he's a bit upset, obviously, of what happened, you know, him breaking the lockdown? Do you think there's a lot of, in what he says there, do you think it would make a difference? Because this is going to be a key point in the inquiry, isn't it? Should we have locked down sooner? This is going to be a key question that the government are going to have to ask, or an answer.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, it's funny enough. I think a little bit of sour grapes there on his part. And it's always good to be wise after the event. And this is something completely new to everyone, new to government, new to certainly the scientific community. Everything is brand new to them. And I really can't understand how someone could say, you should have done this, you should have done that. I say, in hindsight, it's very easy to say.
Yes.
And you mentioned there about an inquiry. Goodness knows how long, as you know, inquiries can take years. By the time this inquiry happens and the results come out, we'd probably gone through another two governments by then.
So I'm joined here today by Sam Dunnett and later Erin Jenkins from Acorn Renters Union. Welcome, guys. We're going to be talking about renters' rights, particularly in Brighton Hove. With the coronavirus outbreak, there's been a lot of concerns by a lot of people that do rent for their accommodation. Sam, maybe start with you first. Tell us what you've been doing recently, because I know you've launched a new campaign.
Yeah, so nationally, Acorn have launched a campaign called Housing is Health. And that's asking national government and local government where they can, where they have the power, to do certain kind of key things that our members, who are predominantly low-income people and renters, really desperately need in this time of crisis. We're facing a homelessness crisis and a kind of debt crisis just over the horizon. So Acorn are really trying to fight back against that, trying to preempt that, and trying to make sure our members have the protections that they need to live in dignity going forward beyond this crisis. So the demands of this campaign are a permanent end to Section 21. This is something that's been promised by successive governments and hasn't been delivered yet. Section 21 of the Housing Act allows landlords to evict tenants for no reason, so-called no-fault evictions. And it's a leading cause of homelessness, and we want it to stop. We're asking for a rent waiver for the duration of this crisis. Our members are people whose ability to earn a wage, ability to bring money in, has been decimated by the lockdown. For those who are on the furlough scheme, that's an unexpected 20% cut in income, which many won't have been able to plan for. I mean, I know myself, I'm just a paycheck away from not being able to pay rent. Many people are facing that situation. And then some people have lost their jobs altogether. Haven't been placed on the government furlough. So we really need people's biggest kind of outgoing to be alleviated, and that's rent. We need that to be taken away. So we want that eviction ban extended as well for a minimum of 6 months.
Yeah. Later, what are you hearing on the ground then, in particularly in terms of Brighton? Because as Sam was saying, a lot of people are a paycheck away from, from being evicted or being unable to at least afford their rent.
Definitely. That's very true. Private rents are very, very high. Rent is the biggest outgoing. And most people are living paycheck to paycheck. As Sam mentioned, the drop from 100% pay to 80% pay for workers on furlough is impacting their ability to be able to pay rent. So it's a massive problem.
I mean, Sam has mentioned about assets, landlords. I mean, this is, people are talking about that great divide, housing divide now, a lot more than they ever were even before the crisis. It's going to be a big talking point in the future, isn't it? That's pretty obvious.
Yeah, definitely. There is that divide. Yeah, with the economic downturn that's coming up. And yeah, there's a lot of concerns about that. It's going to become very obvious what's happening.
Then later, Sam, thanks for talking to us again. All the best with the campaign. We'll catch up again soon.
Thank you very much.
So we're now going to get our football roundup with the Premier League and Brighton Hove Albion. I spoke to Henry Tomlinson in the studio earlier. So welcome back to The Vote. I'm here with Henry Tomlinson, football analyst for Latest TV. We spoke about the bottom five clubs and a bit about West Ham. Should we just finish off on West Ham first and we'll go to Brighton and we'll talk about the top of the table. So West Ham United, then, do you think they're going to be safe?
I think we'll be safe. I can't see us going down. It could be another case of too good to go down, which
famous last words.
Usually the famous last words, and usually means we do end up going down. Yeah. But I think there's a lot of quality in the West Ham squad, and we were playing much better football before the break. The results didn't quite reflect it, but we were unlucky not to get any points from Liverpool and Arsenal. We did very well against Southampton, and we were unlucky not to beat Brighton in what was a comical last 20 minutes, which allowed the draw to be
at Upton Park
at London Stadium.
Yeah, you're right. It was goalkeeping was comical in that.
It was the goalkeeping and defending.
Yeah. All right, we better leave it there then. So I know we're going to be doing this a few more times as well during the season. So that's it for now. Henry, thanks for joining me. And we'll catch up again soon. But that was a vote with Henry Tomlinson. Let's hope the Premier League season gets off to a good start.
That's it for tonight. Join me for more of your local stories tomorrow. Good night.